We are so excited that you have tuned in to the Ludo Network Morning Show. Today, we have some fun, interesting, and exciting information that you are not going to want to miss. I'm Charlie, and Caroline's going to be bringing you the second half of the announcements today. Today is April 20th, 2020. On this day in history, 1916 to be specific, Chicago Wrigley's Field held the first Cubs game of the first National League game being held at the ballpark. The Cubs beat the Cincinnati Reds 7-6 in 11 innings. At this time, please stand for the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please remain standing as we start our Model Elementary School pledge. I pledge to be a person of character. I will be worthy of trust. I will be respectful and responsible. I will show that I care. I will always act with fairness. I will always try my best. I will be a good citizen by following Quirks Up behavior. I'm an essential part of Model. I am Ari, Kenji, Naya, or Pilar. We are Model and we are family. You may be seated. Please pause for a moment of quiet reflection. By Miss Hayes and our first grade teachers.
It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here, you can take a break. I'm a hot air balloon that could go to space. With the air, like I don't care, baby, by the way. Because I'm happy, I'm alone.
Certainly a happy performance. Thank you, Ms. Hayes and first grade teachers. That was fun. Now let's send it over for today's forecast. Over to you, Piper.
Good morning, Blue Devil fans. Today for your weather, we are expecting cloudy skies. Our high temperature will be 73 degrees. Our low temperature tonight will be 46 degrees. The wind will be from the northwest at 6 miles per hour. Our humidity will be 60% and the chance of rain is 70%. For your Tuesday weather, we are looking at temperatures in the 70s and sunny skies. Have a great day. Now I'll send it over to Caroline for the rest of our morning show.
Thank Thank you, Piper. Before we talk about the website of the day, let's listen to Miss Cole read The Kid Changed the World.
Hi, MES family, it's Miss Cole. Today I'm going to read to you The Kid Who Changed the World by Andy Andrews with permission from HarperCollins Publishing. This story is based on a true story, and I think it's very inspirational for today. I want to tell you a story about the kid who changed the world. His name was Norman Borlaug. Norman lived on a farm in Iowa. He loved to play hide-and-seek with his little sisters in their father's cornfields. Norman was tall and skinny, with hair so light it looked like the silk that sprouted from the ears of corn. Norman was very good at hiding in the cornfields. Norman tiptoed quietly so his sisters couldn't hear him. He crept along until he was just close enough to catch them. Gotcha! The girls giggled and squealed. Now you hide, Norman. Norman ran to hide in the field, careful not to knock down any corn stalks. Just yesterday, his father reminded him, "You know, son, we're blessed to have all this corn. There are many people in the world who do not have enough to eat." What would it be like to be hungry all the time? Norman wondered as he looked at the endless rows of corn. There has to be a way this corn can feed the hungry people, he thought. Right then and there, Norman decided to change the world. Norman learned everything he could about plants. When he was grown, he worked for a man named Mr. Wallace. Mr. Wallace said, "Norman, I want you to use what you learned in school to make special seeds. These special seeds will grow into super plants and feed more people than ordinary plants." To make the special seeds, Norman had to go to faraway places and work in the rain and summer heat. But he never gave up. Finally, Norman developed the special seeds that grew into super plants. Norman's special seeds of corn and wheat and rice were sent all over the world, and the super plants fed the hungry people, just like Norman dreamed about as a boy. A whole family could eat dinner from one super plant. And guess what? Norman saved more than 2 billion people from starving. 2 billion! It's true! Norman was the kid who changed the world. Or maybe it was a kid named Henry. I want to tell you a story about the kid who changed the world. His name was Henry Wallace. Henry's father was a professor, and one of his students was a young man named George. Henry loved to go with George on expeditions in the countryside. George knew more about plants than anyone Henry had ever known. Henry peered over the edge of the water to inspect a plant growing on the bank. "Don't get too close to that water, Henry," George said. "Your daddy will have a fit if you get eaten by a hippopotamus." Henry laughed. "Hippos don't live in Iowa. I'm just trying to get a better look at this flower." "You know, Henry, God gave us plants as a way to learn. We can use this knowledge to help others. It's a very important mission." "George, I want that to be my mission. Will you help me?" "Of course. Remember, Henry, God made you to make a difference, and I believe you will." Henry learned so much about plants that he grew up to be the U.S. Secretary of Agriculture. Then Henry Wallace became the Vice President of the United States of America. From that important office, Vice President Wallace, you can still call him Henry, continued his mission to learn how plants could help people. As Vice President, Henry wanted to help people around the world grow more food, so he hired a young man named Norman Borlaug. The same Norman who developed the special seeds that grew into super plants and fed the hungry people. So you see, because Henry is the one who came up with the idea of special seeds and hired Norman to make them, it was really Henry who changed the world. Or maybe it was George. I want to tell you a story about the kid who changed the world. His name was George Washington. Now, before we continue, you must know that he is not George Washington, the president. The U.S. President George Washington lived a long time before the George Washington in this story. George's father died before he was born, and his mother died when he was very young. But the good news is a nice couple named Moses and Susan Carver adopted George and made him part of their family. "Well, George, what have you got there?" asked his neighbor, Mrs. McLeod, as she plopped down on a tree stump beside the young boy. "I'm whittling a crutch for my friend who hurt his ankle." "Just look at you, creating that from a big old tree branch. George, you've got a sharp mind and a kind heart." "Thank you, ma'am, but it's not much. Won't take me too long." "I bet your friend will be mighty grateful for that crutch. You know, George, little things can make a big difference. Everything we do matters. Every action you take, even the small things, can change the world." Sure enough, George Washington Carver changed the world. He became a teacher and inventor. For instance, he invented 266 things from the peanut that we still use today. From the sweet potato, George invented 88 things we still use today. But he did something much more important than that. When George Washington Carver was at Iowa State University, he had a teacher named Professor Wallace. On weekends, George would roam the fields and forests with the professor's 6-year-old son, Henry, teaching the boy about plants and how many ways they could be used to help people. Now let's see here. Norman made the seeds that grew into plants that fed the world's hungry people. But he couldn't have done it without Henry, who had the idea to make super plants and hired him. But Henry would not have had the idea without George, who spent so much time teaching young Henry about plants. So there you have it. George Washington Carver was the kid who changed the world. Wait, we forgot about his mom, Susan. I want to tell you a story about the kid who changed the world. Her name was Susan. She lived on a farm with her mom and dad way up north. Susan pulled nails out of an old barn wood while her pet rooster Buzz watched. "Susan," her mother called as she walked towards her in the field, "what are you doing?" "Well, I figured if I got these nails out of this wood, we could reuse it for something like patching the chicken coop or building a playhouse." "Thank you, Susan. Those are wonderful ideas. I'm sure Buzz will appreciate a snug home come winter," she said with a smile. "He hasn't helped with a single nail," Susan giggled. "You know, dear, every choice you make, good or bad, can make a difference. I'm proud of you for making a good choice today." When Susan grew up, she married a man named Moses Carver, and together with a few workers, they managed a farm. They were very happy, but one night some men tried to hurt them. Outlaws called Quantrill's raiders rode into the farm. They burned down Susan and Moses' barn and kidnapped some of the workers. One of the people they kidnapped was a little boy named George. Susan had to do something. She and her husband searched and searched and finally found young George. Moses and Susan even traded their favorite black horse in return for the little boy. That night, beside the fireplace, as Susan rocked that baby, she told George that they would adopt him. Susan had promised to give the boy their name. As the baby drifted off to sleep, Susan whispered, "Good night, little George Washington Carver." So if Susan and Moses hadn't saved George from the outlaws, George would not have grown up to take Henry on walks in the forest. Then Henry wouldn't have become interested in plants and later hired Norman. Without Henry's idea, Norman wouldn't have developed the special seeds that grew into superplants. And without the superplants, 2 billion people would have nothing to eat. It's odd, isn't it? Every time something happens, something else happens. That's called the butterfly effect. When a butterfly flaps its wings, it moves tiny pieces of air that move other tiny pieces of air that move other tiny pieces of air. In fact, on the other side of the world, they might be feeling a big whoosh of wind, all because of a butterfly flapped its wings here just a few minutes ago. That means every little thing that you do matters. What you did yesterday, what you do today, and what you do tomorrow. God made your life so important that every move you make, every action you take matters. And not only for you or the people around you, everything you do matters for everyone and for all time. When you think about it like that, wow, that means you can be the kid that changed the world. Go change the world, Model Elementary. Have a great day.
Thank you, Miss Cole. Don't forget to take an AR test on the Kid Change the World. Our website of the day is Dance Mat Typing. This website is a fun way to learn typing. You start by learning the home row keys. Each stage builds on previous lessons, introducing new letters as you progress. You'll soon be touch typing like an expert. At the end of each level, you can test your typing speed and get a fun reward. Check out Dance Mat Typing today. You won't be sorry. This information is for all parents and students. Our picture company, LifeTouch, says you can call 1-866-511-3510 and get a personal private code to view your child's portraits online. If you place an order, the package will be shipped directly to your home. There's no deadline to order. On Friday, we discussed Thomas Jefferson and the Louisiana Purchase. Today, let's talk about Lewis and Clark and how they explored this new land. First, let's meet Lewis and Clark. Captain Meriwether Lewis was president, Thomas Jefferson's private secretary. He was in charge of the expedition to explore the newly purchased Louisiana Territory. He asked his friend William Clark to help. William Clark served in the United States Army. In preparing for the expedition, Clark was responsible for hiring and training the men, while Lewis gathered the equipment and supplies they would need. Lewis and Clark, together with their team of over 40 men, began their expedition at the city of St. Louis on May 14, 1804. They packed lots of equipment for their trip, including rifles, food, and warm clothing. They even brought lots of glass beads and trinkets so they could trade with Native Americans along the way. They started out traveling up the Missouri River. Lewis and Clark met many Native American tribes along the way. Although there were some tense moments, they made friends and traded with many different tribes. One particular Native American the explorers met was named Sacagawea. Sacagawea joined the expedition as an interpreter. She helped the expedition in many ways as they traveled, including showing them edible plants and helping to keep peace and trade with different tribes. Without help from the Native American tribes as well as Sacagawea, the expedition would have surely failed. We will talk more about the Lewis and Clark expedition on Wednesday. Well, that's it for me today. I hope you get outside and enjoy the weather today. Until Wednesday, Blue Devils, forks up! Bye!
We are not your ordinary family, but we can all agree that we are close.